Hey, bot builders. In this video, I'll be giving you an overview of what goes into starting an AI agency. I'll take you through the steps of creating and marketing and share with you the lessons that we've learned along the way. Now, you're probably skeptical, and you should be. This space is crowded, and for every well-meaning educator, there's like 10 grifters. So why should you listen to me? Well, you shouldn't. This advice is coming from Patrick Hamlin, the lead growth engineer, and Jean-Bernard Perron, the CFO and COO of Botpress, a top bot building platform selling to and with hundreds of AI agencies worldwide. Between the two of them, they've watched hundreds of AI agencies succeed and, more importantly, fail. After consulting day to day with agencies for nearly a decade, they've graciously agreed to share their experience for this video. Now, this is not going to be a get-rich-quick silver bullet guide, but if you're interested in the space and looking for a grounded, practical guide backed by experience, this one's for you. So let's get to it. Pick your niche. The first step is to figure out what you're going to do. There are a lot of guides out there describing the different options in detail. I can link to some of those, but I'll assume you came here because you've already got some ideas kicking around. I'll just give you advice on how to refine it. Lots of people say, we do everything. Sure. I mean, they sell sushi at my gas station, but I don't want worms. Some gurus are recommending you go on ChatGPT and dig around for low-cost, high-ticket-price businesses. And, I mean, fine. But what are you doing? If you don't have some degree of passion or you aren't sparked by an existing problem, do you really think some language statistics robot is gonna spark some unique creative solution? Think about the industries you know, the frustrations you have. You're selling to humans, so approach this like one. Pick your scale. Most of the grifter bros online pitching AI get-rich-quick schemes are talking about turnkey solutions, a single product that you sell to many clients with little or no customization. You know, basic chatbots. Those are tough to break into because you've got to have a low-cost solution and a reasonably high ticket price. It's got to be general enough to have broad appeal and unique enough to be novel. This isn't to say there aren't a lot of those solutions out there. It's just that, well, a lot of those have been done. Frankly, you can keep it open-ended and offer to build a customized solution. That works, but you'll have to garner a certain amount of credibility. We have partners offering the service. What they have is the receipts, credibility, experience. Customers are ready to believe that they can deliver on their promises because they have a footprint. And I mean, if you're watching this video, the sweet spot here is reusable templates. These are fully fleshed out bots, complete with flow, functionality, and integrations. Then you peel back all the specificity, company information, policy documentation, product inventory, and let customers plug that in, or you do it for them. I call it the sweet spot because it's broad enough that one single workflow can apply across an industry, but specialized enough to make it valuable. Answering the question, what's stopping just anyone from doing it? It combines domain expertise and functionality. It requires specialized knowledge to meet the pain point. It's just up to you to figure out what that is. You know, your niche. If you want an example of this, I'd recommend checking out Matthew's video, where he gives a run-through of Realty AI's Madison. It's a real estate agent used by several different realtors. Pick your tech stack. This is your toolbox, and if you've ever seen a swench, you know there are a lot of tools out there. It's easy to get overwhelmed, so to simplify this, you're gonna need four things. An AI building platform, a CRM, a website builder, and a payment service. Firstly, an AI building platform. What do you think I'm gonna say? I mean, look at the channel name. I'm obviously biased, but there are a few questions you should be asking when deciding on a platform. Will you be relying on RAG? Will you need to implement human in the loop? Will clients be able to change the flow? Will the platform's pricing scale well with your use case? Will you need to integrate with other apps? Next is a CRM. For the CRM, you have two options. Either get a CRM or run circles around an Excel sheet until you eventually break down and get a CRM. In terms of which one to use, you can really tumble down the rabbit hole here. We use HubSpot. It's got a free plan. It's easier to use than Zoho. That's my recommendation. Next, a website builder. If you're not careful, you could turn this into a whole build on top of your product. Lean on the side of simple. Webflow is your best option if you're non-technical. WordPress is a little more cost-effective, but it can be finicky. Lastly, payment service. Stripe. There's one option, Stripe. There, section over. Assemble a team. This one's coming from experience. Successful agencies come in teams. At its simplest, you need someone to build and someone to sell. If you're not one, then you're the other. And if you're both, then, well, gas station sushi. I mean, it could work, but again, in our experience, and we have a lot, we've really only seen success from teams. So, how do you find your other half? Community. Online communities, interest meetup groups, your alumni network. Also, don't underestimate the power of freelancers. There's a plethora of highly capable folks out there for hire to do task work.
Whoa, I'm supposed to hire a rando?
Nah. We're starting small. This isn't a till death do us part. We're just trying to get this off the ground. I'd recommend breaking your needs into tasks. Building the template, making the website, putting together a demo, finding leads, and then looking for the right freelancer to tackle them. Just don't be that weirdo at your nephew's birthday party pitching business propositions. Workflows. Workflows come in two flavors, internal and external. Internal workflows are the tools and systems you use to stay on top of your business operations. For one, what do you do about documents? I bet you're so organized. You would never forget a document or a task. But your clients don't care about that. They're gonna send you all sorts of file formats across different communication channels. It's important that you have a system for keeping track of them. Same goes for tracking progress. It's not enough to keep it all up here. Speaking from experience, if you want a single tool for storing documents, tracking progress, and taking notes, I highly recommend Notion, the sponsor of the, no, I'm just kidding. Notion's affordable and relatively simple, but very powerful. There's also the matter of ownership. It seems silly to think about it in the early stages, but it's best to define your roles early if you want to avoid an ugly Aaron Sorkin litigation. External workflows is the MO of how you deal with customers, from the initial call to product delivery to maintenance and correspondence. Ask yourself, how will you deliver product updates? You've got to maintain it. If you don't, it's called deprecation, and it's where software goes to die. You're best sticking with a regular cadence, for example, weekly, accompanied by a newsletter summarizing the updates. How will you elicit feedback from your clients? You can let them email you whenever, but a pre-composed form can really help streamline and consolidate feedback. How many revisions do you offer? Will you be training the client on integrating the product? How about on using it? A Loom video can save you hours. Just keep your lines open for questions. How exactly you decide to do this isn't so important. What matters is you pick a workflow, commit, and be open to changing what doesn't work. Lead generation. So you've got your product, but if there's no one there to see it, then you're just an intern talking to a camera in a closet. So how do you get yourself noticed in a sea of gurus, founders, and disruptors? There are four basic strategies for marketing. One, cold outreach. You know those LinkedIn messages that start with a greeting and then ask if you're still looking to improve B2B sales? Well, apparently they work. If I don't seem super enthusiastic about it, that's because, well, a few things I will say in favor of cold outreach is it's quick and easy, it's cheap, and it is the fastest way to get feedback on your strategy. If you have a well-defined niche and a concise value proposition, one out-of-the-blue message could be enough to crop a client base. This is best for those turnkey solutions we talked about earlier. Two, lead magnets. You know those content creators offering free pamphlets in exchange for your email? Lead magnets. You're at least relevant enough to want their materials. This doesn't have to be limited to materials. You can offer free consultations too. The advantage here is that you're getting face time with potential clients, which means another chance to make your pitch. Three, partnerships. There's no better advertising than word of mouth. Partnerships let you piggyback off of a more established company's success. Some companies, like Botpress, have an official partners directory. That's not a bad place to start. You can cold call companies to try and establish partnerships, but then you're just cold calling. If you have a pre-established relationship with a client, they can recommend you to tackle services they don't offer. For instance, our friend Realty AI might partner up with real estate networks like REMAX to recommend Madison to any of their real estate agents looking to adopt AI technologies. Four, content marketing. Hi! This is playing the long game, because to establish a voice and an appeal takes a long time just to deliver content to an audience that won't necessarily align with your potential customers. Content marketing is this, right here, what I'm doing right now. It's my full-time job, because the important people have real jobs and you're not gas station sushi. A healthy middle ground is to document the process of building your product. The content writes itself, you're doing the work anyway, it refines your ability to communicate your offer, an underrated skill, and it adds personality and transparency to your brand. So, wrapping it all up, some questions to ask yourself are, how much time do I have to dedicate to this? How much money am I willing to spend? What interests me? Schmoozing online in founder circles or making videos in peaceful solitude? Pick your poison. You're gonna have to make a demo. You don't need a decade of work under your belt. What you do need is some semblance of credibility. One way to get that is to build a prototype. Remember, this is for selling purposes, so it should be product focused. You don't need airtight tech. The point is to deliver a product that saves people having to worry about the technicalities. Another option is to do some pro bono work. I'm a big fan. Getting some firsthand experience, learning the ropes, just, you know, do it well. That doesn't mean it has to be perfect on the first go. It means don't overcommit, define a scope, be realistic, and communicate it clearly. Come prepared, do your homework. What'll work? What tools are available? What limitations might you face? And own your work. Be committed to delivering a good product. fix problems as they arise, and keep an open channel of communication once the work is done. If your service is of any value, someone out there will appreciate the work. If not, maybe hit the drawing board. Okay. Pricing. Pricing isn't about the cost of parts and labor, it's the value of your offer. Find out what competitors are charging and what your edge is. Are you delivering something simple for cheaper, or are you charging slightly more for an improved experience? In addition to the cost, you have to come up with a pricing model. I would recommend a monthly subscription if you're offering a turnkey solution, and setup cost plus monthly maintenance for template-based projects. You can adapt this to your situation. For instance, offer add-ons for a fee, or some maintenance might be more involved, and in that case, you can charge a little more on top of the maintenance fee. It's important to be upfront about the potential costs. It's not worth selling an expensive service if it leaves your customer feeling ripped off. As a general rule, turnkey projects will run $50 to $500 a month. For template-based projects, you're looking at $1,500 to $10,000 for the initial setup, with a monthly fee of anywhere up to $1,000. Fully custom solutions will be anywhere from $5,000 to $50,000 as a flat fee. And definitely don't trap clients with exorbitant hidden costs. Instead, offer valuable, reasonably priced services with transparent pricing. Repeat business does not come from coercion. It comes from goodwill. Legality and compliance. Congrats, you're a business, which means you need to set up an LLC or corporation or SE, depends where you are, open a business bank account, come up with a contract scheme. If you're doing work and expect to be paid, you need to use contracts. I would recommend a starter template from Bonsai or SPP. It should cover the scope, what you're expected to do, and importantly, what you're not expected to do. Payment terms, where, how, and how much. Ownership. Who owns the tech and the outputs? This is especially important if you're dealing in AI-generated content. An out. If shit hits the fan, you need to have a legal out. We use a master service agreement to outline the terms of the contract at the beginning of the partnership, and it applies to all future agreements with the partner. Regardless of your contract, make sure you have a lawyer look it over before you sign. Data privacy and compliance. You're not only liable to following legislation where you operate, but also where your clients and your clients' clients are using your tech from. You do not want legal trouble. Also, you know, basic human decency. I highly recommend getting yourself educated on GDPR, CCPA, and any other regional legislation regarding the use of personal data. Know the regions you'll be operating in before delivering the product. And when in doubt, talk to a lawyer with domain and region-specific expertise. Final thoughts. Okay, so where do you go from here? Start by getting yourself educated. Learn about the niche that interests you. See what solutions exist and where the gaps are. Find people in the space and talk to them. Hear their thoughts, hear their experiences. Getting informed will be your best defense against scams, market busts, and costly errors. It seems complicated, and it is, but you're still watching, which means you're passionate. Pursue that, and the rest will fall into place. Well, I hope you enjoyed today's episode of Intern Tells You How to Run a Business. If you'd like the info in written form, my colleague Sarah wrote a great article. If you're looking to get your hands dirty with bots or explore the possibilities, I'll leave links to Botpress's platform and Discord. Oh, also, don't do evil shit with AI, please. There's so many ways you can help people, like healthcare, NGOs. Don't, like, scam elderly people. And let me know in the comments what you'd like to see next. Till then, happy bot building!